Welcome back. Today we're going to learn something new together, and that new thing that we're learning is a program that helps generate code for your programs. Not exactly, but it helps generate numbers that are constants that are used by your application. And it helps so you don't manually have to tune many numbers. You can use a program to generate these numbers for you. So this program, I forget what it's called. The application itself is called SPSA, SPSA Tuner. And it's based on an algorithm. I forget what the algorithm letters stand for, but I think it's stochastic process, something automation. But the idea is if you have a multi-dimensional space, you can, instead of performing, instead of checking just a single derivative and doing the traditional, it's not simplex, but the traditional walk through a space based on If you have a multi-dimensional space and you're attempting to guess where the optimal, what they call the minimum, but what the optimal value is, where the point is in that 2D, 3D, n-dimensional space, if there's a point out there which is the point that has your optimal values, you want to be able to navigate to it. And that navigation involves some experimentation and measurement, and then from that measurement you can choose a direction from where your current values are. Generally the old style, the simplest way that this could be performed would be to look at the dimension that has the greatest error, the greatest measurement error, however you choose to perform said measurement, and change that dimension first, and then do another measurement on just that one dimension, and look at all your errors, and take another step based on which step brings you closest to the optimal value. So, let me see. So here's that concept in equation in math or science, mumbo jumbo formulas. But if you want something of a more visual nature to help describe that, just imagine that you've got an agent, a robot, something in an n-dimensional space, and it's trying to measure how close it is to, say, some goal or some exit that's contained in this space. And so as this agent moves about the space trying to identify where that optimal value, where that goal is at, it's able to perform some measurements and come up with some concept, even though those measurements are flawed and have some level of error to them. It's able to use those in combination to figure out which direction to go to get closer toward that goal. And so that's a more visual explanation. Unfortunately, this is all going to be source code coding, so it's not going to... we're going to have some challenges trying to explain this. I'm sorry, I need to give credit to the author of this algorithm, Professor Spall at Johns Hopkins University. Authored a paper, I think it was in 1998, I could be mistaken. Here's the URL to that paper. If you look up Spall and SPSA on any search engine, it should return this paper for you, as he was the one, I believe he authored the algorithm or heuristic. But if not, he's at least the one who I think was first to write all the math behind it, explaining how this works. The idea is that when you are approaching the goal, you don't have to approach it orthogonally. You don't have to approach the goal by moving in a single axis at once. You can move in all the axes at the same time, if you're clever about the way in which you do it. And so this allows variables to be tuned faster. Incidentally, using the same number of iterations to come up with the approximation, even though it is ultimately the values that we come up with here at the end of this algorithm are only an approximation because our measurements aren't perfect. If our measurements told us exactly where to find the optimal values, we wouldn't have to do any of these algorithms. We'd do a single measurement and then we would change the values and then that would be done. Realistically, what's going to happen, and now I'm going to speak about this in the context of chess, is that we have a chess program that has some constants in it. For example, let me scroll down a bit. Let's get to the section I'm interested in tuning. So here we have numerous constants just lying in a chess program. And the question is, what should the values of these constants be such that the chess program wins as often as possible? Now, obviously there's more constants than just these listed here. There's constants throughout the entire program. Really, all I'm going to focus on for purposes of my initial testing and development here is the set of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 sets of constants here, which represent a pawn being on the opponent, on your 8th rank, on your 7th, on your 6th, 5th, 4th, 3rd, and 2nd. Now, keep in mind, you never get a pawn to the top rank of the board. You never get a pawn beyond the further back beyond the rank on which it started. So the fact that there's an omission here, and that really what this could read it like an 8x8 board. If you imagine this being the bottom, this being where your pawns initially start, and as they go up the board, various bonuses apply. But we don't need that final constant, so it's just not there. So yeah, for purposes of what I'm doing here, I want to tune these values. I'm not sure the best way to do this. There's probably tons of different ways to do it. In fact, maybe I should just start with a subset of these. Now I understand. I've read through some of this documentation before. So I think this corresponds to the first, second, third, and fourth columns of the chessboard. And then I think it flips after that and goes 5th, 6th, 7th, and 8th columns of the chessboard. I think this is symmetric, if I remember correctly, and maybe I don't. So here's an explanation. Bonus of piece type square over 2 contains piece square scores. For each piece that's on a given square, a middle game, comma, end game score pair is defined. It's interesting the way this is explained is, not square over 2. This is, maybe the documentation's a bit dated. Maybe not. Let's see. Okay. So this first dimension where it says variant number, you can ignore that. The second one, piece type number or count, corresponds with the piece type count. These other two dimensions correspond to the number of ranks and number of files on the chessboard, which corresponds to what you see visually here. I'm a bit confused. What's the usage of this bonus? So I'm going to take a quick look at that. I don't want to get too bogged down into my application code if I can help it. Okay, so when we set up bonuses for all the squares. Oh, I get it. So this is asking, which is less, the count of the number of files from the left side or from the right side of the chessboard? Whichever of those is less, then use that as the key into this array. So we're assuming that the weights of pieces on squares are symmetric, which is probably wrong, but it's a useful approximation, I suppose. And okay. So let's go back down to our section of the code down here that we're going to be tuning. So what I'm going to focus on, first of all, is these squares, which are squares on the seventh rank of the chessboard. So if they were to move, if you placed a pawn on one of these squares and you moved it forward a square, it would promote into a piece of your choosing. Normal chess, this tends to be quite good. In this particular variant, putting a pawn on the seventh rank tends to be absolutely annihilating. And so we made a change to this, the values that are listed here recently. We increased all the values on that rank by 15. Hey, welcome. So yeah, what I'm going to do next, I could show off, SPSA is the tool that I'm going to be using to perform tuning. So according to the README, I did do a brief summary of what this tool is, but let's see it in action and maybe I can better explain it that way. So the way you're supposed to use this tool, you install all the libraries you need, and usage is first change your source code in order to make parameters available via input, via just IO commands, in this case via particular kind of input. And then create a configuration file and a variable file, and then kick off the tuner. Okay, so we'll take a quick look at each of those. So I've already done this for the engine. Much of this is already prepared by Ian here. I'm forgetting, his username I think is Ian, but I think his name is Fabian. If he stops by, we'll let him know and give him credit. I'll link to this so other people can use the software that he helped develop and make sure the credit's given to him. This parameters file has two sections, the main section, which corresponds to parameters of the tuner, and the second section, which corresponds to information related to the program that you're invoking. In this case, it's an engine. Well, I suppose it's always an engine, I'm not sure, but in this case, we're invoking a chess engine by the name of Stockfish. And using some set of preset files. So that's file number one, it's the configuration file. Secondarily, we have the variable file, which this is the set of UCI parameters that are passed into the engine before it plays the game. And we have a number of values here. I'm not entirely sure what all these values represent. I have to consult the documentation regarding that. This is actually going to get kind of ugly when it comes to more complicated things, as we'll see soon. You'll note that if you run the program, again, the program I have is Stockfish here, so if I just run that and I type in UCI, Stockfish accepts all of these parameters. debug and contempt and threads and hash and clear and ponder and so forth. One of these that actually does not accept is the one that's shown in the variable file, which is aggressiveness, and that's okay. It just means that parameters that we pass in to help tune this aren't going to do very much in terms of tuning. Actually, one thing we could do that's kind of hilarious is we could change aggressiveness, I think, to skill level and bound that between 20, between 0 and 20 with a default of 20 or with a default of 10. But as I'm not sure what's the appropriate way to configure, not this, but the data variables. I'm not sure what all those values represent. Probably 30 is a default, probably 0 is the minimum, 200 is the maximum. I'm not sure if 10 means the largest step and 0.002 is the smallest step. I don't know. I don't know what this 0 corresponds to. But let me just kick this off. Follow the step in the README, which is spsa.pl, and then the config file. And the config file references references the variable file, so that's how it knows what values to pass into the engine. And so, yeah, here we are. It's performing simulations, passing in values of aggressiveness. And what it probably won't discover is that aggressiveness is not something that the engine actually uses. So, like, now if we look at our log files that got created, not that one. Here we go. So here we see there's a number of parameters that were passed into the engine, and we see that the value that it's passing in each time. You actually get the best use out of this, I understand, but I have not tested, if you pass in multiple, if you have multiple parameters to tune. That's when you really want to be using this program, as it knows how to intelligently tune multiple parameters between iterations. Curiously, in all of this, there's no documentation of the warnings or errors or info messages that come back. I would have expected the log to be even more verbose. Let me add one more character. So our log files are about 64k a piece. What I could do, that's how we figure it out. So there's about 700 lines in the log file that is quite verbose, but it doesn't provide the feedback. Like, say if I were to pass in this parameter, aggressiveness with a value of 30. Watch what happens if I do this. Set option, name, aggressiveness, value 30. It responds no such option, aggressiveness. And this is being ignored by the tuner. And I think before I get too far into this, I actually do want to provide more feedback in the log file. So let me see. Yeah, so that's interesting. Okay. Print must not be printing to the console, but must be printing to the engine. Oh, I see. Engine 1 writer, engine 2 writer. So this is how it lets the engine know what the value is. But it must not be reading in the output from the engine to confirm that that it successfully read the values. Oh, here we are. Yeah, so until it receives the ready OK message, it does nothing. I would much rather this prints something to the log every time the engine prints something out until the message says ready OK. So where is my log file inside here? If I search for log, is that gonna log path? Game log path, open shared log file. This is Perl, so I'm not so familiar with it, but I assume that this means that when I open the log path, that I'm putting the reference to the file that I'm opening into variable log. I could very much be wrong about that. Okay, here we have a message, log auto flush. Where else is log used? Log is closed. Okay, here's syntax for printing out information. Print log log line. Is that the only way to use it? Probably. Actually, if I'm not comfortable printing to the log file, maybe I just want to print out to the, not to the console, but to standard out. Let's see, what sorts of things do we end up printing to standard out? Like we say iteration colon etc. variable colon, so maybe I search for iteration. Okay, so here's how I print a message. Yeah, and here we are back to that. Now, how do I do a loop in Perl? Okay. In fact, we're doing a loop already. The way this author is indenting their code is like this. So I will follow suit. And then 1, 2, 3, 4. Print, and then I'm not sure how to extract what it is that was just read from engine read line. Yeah, it does try to find optimal values for sure. Do I extract the value that was read by engine read line? Oh, in fact, here's engine read line. It's right down here. Let me grab these lines of code in case they help me later. Chomp line, return line. So maybe I just print line? Maybe that's okay. Similarly here, print line. We're learning Perl, guys. That seems to follow the syntax that's exercised elsewhere. So it should probably work. Let's find out how far off the mark I am. So we run this the same way. Okay. Yeah, use of uninitialized value line. So that's a bummer. Okay, so if I'm performing assignment in Perl, see, I don't want to always do this when reading a line from the engine, because there's just too much to read and too much to write. I want to say something like, oh, in fact, the line is declared up here earlier. I want to check something like that. And do the same thing down here for engine 2. I don't know if I can do that kind of right. Yep. One step ahead of you, but in this other cases I might not be. Hey, cool. It did a thing. Don't know if that's right or not. Oh yeah, no, that totally worked. So that wasn't printing what I expected to see, but it did print out the output from engine 1 and engine 2. What I was expecting to see is that aggressiveness is not a parameter. And what are you doing? But, okay, I developed something useful that wasn't what I thought it would be, but it's still there. Oh, hang on. Now I'm starting to maybe understand the point of some of this. So let's see. Iterations equals 50,000, A equals 5,000. See, I'm not sure how those constants are used. I very well may need to consult the documentation regarding that. Because 50,000 is a lot of iterations. Like, say I change this from 50,000 to 5. 5 is obviously too few, but also I'm not sure what the rest of these are used for. I mean, yeah, that's a thought, but no, I think the point of the two engines is that it can provide different parameters to both engines and see which one wins. And so, I mean, yeah, you could do it, you could have a control group and could have a varying engine, but I think the purpose of this is that, in fact, we could see from this logging, I assume? I could be wrong. I'm almost certainly wrong. In fact, yeah, that would be really confusing. So probably it just compares a control to... Well, we could read the code and see how it's performed. I did, this morning, look at the README, and it didn't make any mention of, as far as I could see, of whether the varying parameters are changed to for just one engine or for both engines. Calculate the parameters for each variable. Oh. Okay. Wait. So where are these passed into the engine? Engine init if not simulate. I quit engine 2 games. So the varying parameters, I can't tell from this. I guess I could look at the log. Yeah, I don't see any of that here. So I'm not sure. I don't know how to answer your question. The point is that you have two engines that have different parameters. And you see which parameters are better. But I do not know whether one of those has already perfectly tuned parameters, at least best based on what's already known and whether the opponent changes their parameters or whether both engine parameters are changing. I don't know. Yeah, certainly the engines play against each other. But the question is, like, what you were asking, is it compared to an already tuned engine? Or is this just two engines with parameters that keep changing? To see which set of parameters is better. I'm not sure. I was going to guess the latter, that the parameters for both engines change with every match. Yes, I'm a bit confused. Var ENG. Are both of these recomputed with every iteration or just one? Okay. So here we see for each variable, for each row in the set and list variables, the value of var underscore ENG1 is it's equal to the current, I'm sorry, this var value plus var c times var delta bounded between max and min. So this c times delta, I believe, is what changes. Well, I think all these parameters change with each iteration. The value, which is listed here. The C and the delta. I think all three of those change with each iteration. And it keeps tuning among the parameter space until it finds a reasonable combination of those values for each variable. And it's tuning all the variables simultaneously. So the value is value, A is A, C is C, R is R. Where does R come from here? That comes from A divided by C squared. I wonder if R is a regression constant. I guess the idea here is that your value can increase or decrease. And engine 1 and 2 are taking the plus and minus side of that and seeing which engine performs better. Just based on the result of, as we see down here, as I think I saw people commenting in the Google discussion, that this simulates two games at a time. Maybe it wasn't the Google discussion, but maybe it was, it's a Stockfish. It's the official Stockfish team discussing points using the Google forum. That's what it was that I was looking at earlier. But yeah, each simulation, it plays a pair of games, one white, one black for each engine, and sees just what the results are, and then applies the results. But yeah. So your question, the two engines play against each other. They come up with a value as well as a C and a delta. And the product of that C and delta can change over time, obviously. I'm a bit confused. So C, I think one of these is invariant and one of these varies throughout the course of the program. I could have sworn that C is a constant that gets, I mean, algorithmically, like in formulas, you very often see that C is a constant. So this is probably established by something that's constant throughout the duration of the program. I could be wrong. Whereas the delta that's come up with, where does this var delta come from? I don't know. But yeah, the code is all there if you want to peruse through it and figure out what it's for and how it works. I'm just glad that it works, frankly. But so okay, this reads in the list of parameters from the engine up through the UCI OK statement. I wonder, maybe the reason I'm not seeing that aggressiveness is not a valid option is because I'm trying to think how to say this, but maybe it's printed to standard error instead of standard out. Anyhow, surely that's logged somewhere, right? Engine 1 and engine 2 writer. That sounds like a pretty generic thing that I would expect to find somewhere in this file. I suppose I could check the Stockfish source code and figure out why I'm not seeing that aggressiveness is not listed as an option. So this would be in Stockfish source code. Yeah, it's not there. So instead, we're going to take a quick look at this, figure out. Okay, here's a set option. Yeah, no, it does print out no such option for sure. And yeah, I'm confused. Did I just miss it? Why did I not see no such option displayed anywhere in this output? Author, option name, option variant, and so forth. Yeah, that's. I suppose it's possible that the UCI OK statement was printed before the error messages. I hadn't considered that, but that very well could be the case. So I need to go elsewhere where we're doing a read line. I don't want to embed the log or the printing. Well, maybe I do. No, it's just way too much to be printing all the time. But yeah, let's do it this way. Maybe this is all I needed to add. Is there anywhere else that we do reading lines from an engine? I think this is once we've already started the game. And this would be completely overwhelming if we were to print out every engine evaluation. Okay, so I think this should be more useful. So now I can attempt the this again. Find the configuration file. Oh, I broke it. Guys, it's all broken now. Diff, what did I break? How did I break it? Oh, I removed the empty braces. Shame. Oh, okay. Yeah, I need to reintroduce this. And this is really, we're already in territory where I should have created a helper method a long time ago now. Because now I've got the same code repeated not once, not twice. It's not printed here three times, but it's repeated. It's repeated three times for being in here, a total of four times. But, okay, we're not going to bother doing that with everybody watching. Okay, here we are. No such option aggressiveness. So, that is useful feedback for sure. And I think, yeah, the rest of that feedback is still pretty useful too. So you can see for each iteration what's being performed is that these parameters are being provided to the engine. With the value of 29.9 something, and your C constant being that 23, 22 number, it keeps changing. I think R is still the regression constant. Or I'm sorry, the regression, I don't know. I want to say result, but there's probably a better word. And I think that A is the number that gets multiplied by C. So the values that are provided to the engines are 29 plus or minus 21 times that 0.8. If I'm reading correctly, and maybe I'm not. Okay, where was that calculate? Here it is. Yeah, it'd be nice to print this out in a manner that's a little bit easier to read. Let's see. I need to grab the Unicode symbol for plus minus. This is C times delta. Far delta name. So this isn't even providing the full story. Let me take a look for var. Oh, here it is. Var delta. So I think they call this a Bernoulli distribution, where if your random number here is, it's either a plus one or a minus one. So this is random with each iteration. I suppose the actual delta doesn't matter. But that tells it which direction to either increment or decrement. Okay. That's curious that that's... Well, no, you could still learn something if you... What's the point of having delta be plus 1 or minus 1, though? I wonder, because here we have a plus and a minus. That just seems very strange to me. I guess the... Oh, I'm sorry. There is a point to that. point is that you don't always want engine one to be on the plus on the positive side. You don't always want engine two to be on the negative side. So let's see. But I still want this to print. I would prefer to see it expressed this way. Let's see, can I put this in parentheses and perhaps get an expression in here? Var delta. Well, that's kind of messy now, isn't it? You know, just to be safe, I should probably evaluate that prior to that line of code. So I guess what we're going to do, in fact, let's put it all these other expressions here. My step. Step's an awful name, but okay. Equals var c dollar name times var delta. Why am I doing this here though? Why is var delta even a thing? Let's search for var delta through the rest of this file. I think there's a simplification that's possible. Yeah, so it's only used, it's used in that other context as well. Just seems awfully kludgy. But yeah, we see it's only used in a handful of places. So, in fact, I forgot. You can also specify things this way. I think there's a difference between values and references and pointers and such, and I don't know all the nuances. I did read about it once, but Perl is still somewhat of an enigma to me. But okay, shared theta at the end of each step is computed as var underscore r, which I think is the result of that particular match of two games, times var c times result. I'm just going to have to trust that whoever did this knew what they were doing. But it seems strange to me that you wouldn't just multiply c by delta. Oh, okay, I'm sorry. There is a point to this. It's that if you have a more complicated distribution function, you could put that distribution function here instead. In this case, our distribution function is a simple Bernoulli flip a coin function, where it's either heads or tails, plus one or minus one. Here's how we do it. This is unambiguous. Well, I don't know if delta is the best variable name for that. There's still got to be a better way to express this. Yeah, okay, I have a better idea. We're going to change some pretty fundamental code here, but I think it's going to be okay. So we're going to change var underscore delta to already have applied this multiplication step. And that way we don't need to be doing this multiply by delta, divide by delta all over the place. I mean, yes, C is the constant. I guess if it makes people more comfortable, we could just call this var D. Well, no, we already had a parameter. It's called delta. Okay, so this is like a little bit scientifically impure the way I'm doing it, but but in terms of actual code that gets executed, doing that multiplication step allows us to eliminate a lot of code and make this a bit easier to understand from that point of view. I mean, how often are we using this var c throughout the file anyway? Well, I'm sorry, I haven't changed the value of var c. All I've changed is the value of var delta, which only matters on the lines where we actually use it, such as this line here. Okay, so I suppose the point of separating that is that you could come up with a more accurate theta value down here. Never mind, so I'm not going to change that constant. Instead, in this one context, I am going to do what I originally suggested I do. This introduces another variable, but that's okay. Really, that's the value I care about. It's not some big convoluted something or other, it's just delta. And yeah, I think my original name step was probably more accurate. Just so there's no confusion with the math formulas that are used. Hopefully this file does not use step for anything else. So then way down here we're able to divide out var delta when we're done. So that way this formula is preserved in its original state, and that's okay. So the value of a, var underscore a name is equal to capital A plus iter. Okay, at least iter can't be confused with step. Yeah, I'm just trying to come up with the best name here. Delta is probably actually the best name, probably better than step. I'm going to change this. Sorry, I keep changing my mind here. It's probably driving everybody crazy. Oh, but now it prints out delta. I don't like that either. Because a person reading this isn't going to know what delta means. Delta is your distribution function. So I have to keep this separate. It has to have a unique name so that person reading this can understand that delta is not a randomly generated number here out of a distribution. It's the product of the number of that distribution bounded by plus 1 and minus 1. It's the product of that with the value of a. I'm sorry, the value of c, which is your constant, which changes with each iteration as tuned by gamma. I haven't actually looked at what tunes gamma or what changes gamma. Oh, it's just a constant defined in a file, right? Okay. So, yeah, if we look at this configuration file, it has to define, yeah, alpha and gamma. Now, 50,000 iterations is still quite a lot, but anyway, let's run this. Line 244. Oops, not that file. This one. Yep, so I have messed up. Oh, I forgot. When you specify variables in Perl, you need to specify them like this. No, that's not right. What have I done incorrectly? How is that not working? My step equals the product of those two numbers. What have I done wrong? Global symbol dollar name requires explicit package name. Now, I guess when I declare a variable, I don't have to declare it globally. But I thought my was used to specify something in a local scope. But maybe you can only use my if there's already something in a global scope that has the same name that conflicts. Like down here, we have a thing called my row. And so. Thing called my name. Oh, I'm sorry. This is Perl. We need a semicolon there. Okay. So yeah, now we get to see here's the value, here's the A, the step, and the R. So we're looking at 29 plus or minus 23. I'm still not sure what where A comes from. I'm sorry, A. See, my configuration file defines a parameter gamma, which is used to help tune the value of A, which defines, I think, how quickly your step changes or how large your step is. I think also the result of the previous outcome has an impact on the step size. And I think the reason that not all these lines are exactly the same width is because some of these have end in a zero. Like here, this single A value isn't, it doesn't have as many decimal places because this last digit would be a zero. It'd be nice to print that out in a easier to read format, or one that printed out the same number of digits each time so things lined up properly. But also we see no such option aggressiveness. So now I need to take a moment and go back. And yeah, I understand that aggressiveness is not an option. But I do need to adjust these variable settings here. So I'm trying to figure out, I know what 30, 0, and 200 mean. This means the default value, minimum, maximum. I'm not so clear on what the next three values, the 10, the 0.002, and the 0 are for. So I need to read the source code. Name seems to be the thing defined that seems to be the way that they specify a variable in this scope. Oh, but this comes from a list called variables. So let's search the file for variables and see where these are read in. Variables path, read them into the list variables for each variable. Okay, so we need to have a name, a start value, a maximum, a minimum, a C end, an R end, and a simul elo. Okay. I think I can leave simul emo at elo at zero. And we can always change that later. I don't think that's going to impact the test at all. It just impacts the formula at the end of everything, if I understand right. But C end and R end. I assume that R end, yeah, if we hit the value of R, hitting that, then we're done. I'm not sure if that means R exceeds that value or is less than that value, but once we've hit some value, we're done. And C, I assume, means the number of iterations. So CN times iterations times gamma. Oh, maybe CN is just the final value of C to use. RN is the final value of R to use. I did not see it read in a value of var a end. That's curious. Var a end is, this is where it's calculated. Okay. So a end is r times C squared. How am I supposed to read this? So calculate SA parameters for each variable. C to use is just going to be the C n times the number of iterations to the power of gamma. That seems an interesting way to do things, but okay, I guess. I'm not sure why only iterations gets raised to the power of gamma. That must be a way of defining the step. No. I guess if you change the number of iterations that this will execute, then it needs to change its minimum step size accordingly. I think C is just supposed to be the constant that's used as a constant to help determine step size. So C and R. I assume that R is if you hit some threshold. Okay, in fact, yeah, the next line says var A end is equal to R end times C end squared. Why would you square C end to figure that out? Regardless, it's some kind of threshold that says when we're done. Let's take another look at, okay, and then the value of A is equal to A end that we just calculated up here times A plus iterations. Okay, so this must be going through some set of pre-calculated A plus iteration values for each iteration. I'm not sure. I'm forgetting some very relevant pieces of information, such as what A, C, and R are used for. Okay, so 10.02 and 0. We can ignore the 0, because that just has to do with estimating a rating based on everything. It's probably not the most critical thing ever. I'm sorry, it was 10 and then 0.02. And that 10 gets read in as var C end. That's curious. So I would have expected that if we stray from our value by more than some constraint C, I guess, then we're done. And we need to perform a different test because we exceeded, because we're moving so far away from our initial state that something needs to just be verified before we go further. It makes sense to constrain your tests, and I assume that that's what the C is for, is it's just some kind of constraint. And then that 0.02, I assume that means that if we estimate that our next step size is less than that threshold, we're done. So if we have something that's more precise than 0.002, then we've definitely succeeded at our test. That's me just trying to interpret this all. Let me just take one more look at how var C and var A are used. It's this var A is equal to the A that we computed earlier, divided by A plus iteration to the power of alpha. A plus iteration to the power of alpha, and initially the A here is A plus iterations to the power of alpha. This dollar A comes from, I'm not sure. I think that's the alpha that was defined in the file. Not in the variable file, but in the info file, which defines the parameters of the test. So that parameter is also relevant here. But okay, this is A end, which is calculated up here as R end, which is the value we input, times C end squared. I know math just must be thrilling for you guys, especially because it's my understanding that now at this time the Crazy House Championship has started, as of 3 minutes ago. And I'm still trying to figure out the correct way to perform this tuning. But I can guess some values, and then we can see what happens. So instead of varying aggressiveness between, let's get that, just print it out here. Aggregate, I assume that that's what AGGR is. Oh, I'm sorry, that's for aggressiveness. Okay. Let's take a look at simul1var.conf. Simulate. Yeah, I think that simul1 is just a generic simulation of sorts. But this does inspire me to try something slightly different here. We're going to copy the aggressiveness. In fact, what have I changed? I've changed this so. I did change the README a little bit to be more scientifically accurate, but whatever. To be more formal, rather. Not to say that it's impossible in practical terms, but that. Just the randomness that we have is going to make it computationally expensive to come up with the right numbers. I'm sorry, not the right numbers, the ideal numbers. We can still come up with good estimates, but ideal numbers are difficult to compute. So, because aggressiveness doesn't exist anymore, I should rename these files. What do I want to try tuning, just for an example? Let's try tuning. I was going to say skill level. It might still be the thing I say here. Yeah, let's actually do skill level. Hash would be another interesting thing to try to improve. Actually, something that might make more sense is contempt. Oh no, that doesn't make any sense. Never mind. That's a highly situational sort of thing. But yeah, let's try skill level. So we're gonna move this file. So we don't get errors. Skill level varies. Has a default value, I think, of 20. Let's start it at 10. Going between 10 and 20. I'm not entirely sure what 10 there is for, but let's try this. Looking for a precision of 0.02. And then that's not what I want to list either. I want to see what do I have out there still. Variables equal to skill.var. Which lists all the variables. There we go. I'm going to try this again and see if it figures out that skill level 20 is strongest. So we'll see how long it takes to come up with that conclusion. Skill.conf. Invalid name, skill level. Right. So I don't think this handles names that have spaces in them. Does interestingly handle names that have braces, but does not handle names that have spaces inside them. Wait, how did it print this out? I think, yeah, it did get the correct, well, if I add a space in here, we're gonna get some interesting effects. Hopefully that doesn't capture the entire line, because if so, then that's going to be sad. Let's try that. Okay. Oh, wow. That's initial step of 24 is quite extreme, I think. And so here we see that skill trends upward toward 20. Oh, in fact, it seems to be capped at 20. Oh, good. So this makes me wonder, what if I change this back to its initial value of 0.0020, and I try this again? Is this going to step too quickly, too slowly? It might be a bit too slow here, because it's... you can see, obviously, it's exploring the entire space. But... values it comes up with are not necessarily integer values. Probably should be providing those as integers to the program. Okay, so we see that R does now exceed that 0.002 threshold. I'm curious why the test is still ongoing, if that's the case. And it certainly seems to be the case that we've hit some level of confidence R. I'm not sure what the R is for. But yeah, you see through many tests that we're able to provide skill level in each iteration. Let me just double check. Skill level. Okay, it's not logged. I'm curious how we provide that to the engine. Because what happens if I do this? Set option, name, skill level, value. That number. And it sets the skill level. Set option. Yeah, I'm not sure that's making a difference. Value 15. Yeah, how do I know what the values that it currently are set to are? I guess one way I could know, quit the program, GCI, set option, name, skill level, value 0.25, ready, okay, okay, I forget how to say I'm done. Setting options. S- So I'll say go in go time 8 seconds. Yeah, I don't know how to tune that. Okay, regardless, we shouldn't be providing decimal values to as an integer value. That needs to be an integer. How do I make that into an integer in Perl? Well, yeah, that's the thing is, I've looked at the tournament announcement. Unfortunately, it's apparently run on a command line interface, or at least there's no announcement about how to watch it live. So, the match has started, and all I can do is just refresh the page until results come pouring in. My particular... Yeah, I know. I have to cut them a little bit of slack, though. They did manage to reach out and contact all the engine authors and manage to put this tournament together. And they're pretty precise about how they're going to run it. And it's probably somebody just running it in some, I don't know, factory-ish sort of environment. So... It's very well regulated, I guess. I don't know. It's a lot of effort to put together the competition or contest in the first place. I really appreciate that they're doing it, and I appreciate that they're posting the results, and hopefully what would be really cool is if when they post the results, if they also post the source game so that a reenactment can be had. Maybe I'm getting my hopes up a little too high for that, but it'd be awesome if that could be done. And if not, I just might have to put my own bot online, which I probably will do soon anyhow. I do have a bug I have to test for very soon, having to do with just being able to connect a program to the internet and play against people online. On a particular kind of chess server. Oh, here we are, nearest. Where is this defined? Okay. Send rounded values to engines. So there is some hope that this is actually doing what it claims to be doing. Interesting. Let me try one other thing here, and that's if I view this and I change this cap from 10, say, to 4, what do we get now when I run this? Hopefully, upon concluding that 10 is worse than 11, which is worse than 12, etc., hopefully it concludes that 14 is the strongest that it encounters. Oh, I see what's happening. I'm sorry, I forgot that what's used here, I think, is the product. I forget what A is for. Maybe I should reorder some of this. But I think it's competing 10 plus or minus the step, right? Sorry to have cut that short, but so this here. I'm sorry, this. I made my variable called step. While some people might be concerned about what this A is, I'm a lot more concerned about what step is. cursor moved the wrong way. There we are. Thank goodness for syntax highlighting. And then maybe I do want to, okay. Yeah, do enjoy cooking breakfast. So I'm gonna grab the plus minus, here we are. That character off of a clipboard. Plus minus a step. That's how I want to express it. And now, of course, I don't need to express it this way. Well, it doesn't hurt. It's going to look silly because step. Could be negative, but that's the general idea. Oh, there's a function called abs. I think it gives you abs or something. No. Let's do like this, and then say step is equal to absolute value of step. And this should be okay. This should, yeah. 10 plus or minus 10.37, 10 plus or minus 10.0, etc. Now 10 is kind of a large step size. So I'm concluding that that value, not in this conf file, but in the variable file, that, well, no, 10's the default. If I decrease this to 1, what do I get? Okay, yeah, I have initial step size of 1, which makes a lot more sense. 10 is a huge step size. You don't want to initially start by stepping the entire size of the pool. So it'll, after much experimentation, it'll eventually conclude. I don't know. Maybe I do change this back to something larger. My initial setting was 10, which, yeah, puts our skill values at something outrageous. Okay, so I'm not sure what value to use here. Ten plus or minus 12. Well, Stockfish doesn't care if you put the value over 20. I think it still uses the maximum value of 20. I'm not sure what a good initial value is. Let's try something a bit smaller. So, yeah, now it's competing level 3 versus level 18, and probably quickly going to conclude that the higher level Stockfish is a lot stronger. The other thing is, if I'm feeling impatient, I can go into here and change the number of iterations and even the alpha value. I'm not sure what changing alpha is going to do. So I'm not going to touch that, but I'll change the number of iterations from 50,000 to 5,000. And actually, for the sort of thing that I'm going to end up ultimately doing, I'm curious if in 50 iterations we can arrive upon the best value. Because what I'm looking for are some really extremely rough approximations for correct values. Not correct, but just good estimates. Yeah, there's some magic to this and some science to it. But what this should conclude after some or much testing. See, it's halfway through its test, actually. I didn't realize that the tests would go so quickly. So it's going to fail to converge upon anything larger than 10 here. I think. I mean, yeah, you can see how slowly that is approaching the value of 11. Let me increase this back up just a little bit. So I'm curious, just in the course of 50 iterations, and then next I can try 500. Is this going to produce more or less accurate results? In this case, we happen to know that skill level 0 is the weakest and 20 is the strongest. And so what this is doing is repeatedly pitting 0 against 20 here. And now I think we might be pitting 1 against 21, but there is no 21, there's just a 20. And so we see that here are value, our estimate keeps increasing with each iteration. Now I said, you know, we're just doing 50 iterations. And so yeah, the estimate I came up with is that 11.67. And then you could redo the test starting at 11.67 and see where you end up. But more as an academic exercise here, I'm going to change iterations to 500 and see just how far it goes. Ultimately, what I'm going to be changing in the Stockfish source code was those lines of code we saw earlier, which are constants for the values of pawn drops on the 7th rank of the chessboard. So yeah, really the directions for this say you can cut it off at any time. And figuring out the right threshold to cut it off is as much a science as it is an art. Just some people who have understanding of what the values mean may be using this to help them look for a value. But yeah, interpreting the values that come back takes a little bit of work too. In this case, we happen to know the exact interpretation, and that's that the program will make poor moves unless it's I'm trying to think how to express this, but the lower its skill level, the poorer the moves that it performs or makes. And so we're looking at skill level. Here we have matches between skill level 1 versus 23, just based on these numbers here. And now we have 2 versus 24. And I'm just curious how quickly it's going to converge upon 20, as well as is it going to stop at 20 or is it going to try to go beyond that? How long will it take for the program to recognize that 20 is a really good value? In this case, we happen to know that's the ideal value because at skill level 20, it plays the best move that it finds. And the best move does have some variability in it. There is some randomness in the chess engine, so it's not predictable. If you had a chess engine that was completely predictable, the opponent that would beat it would use that same engine as part of itself and predict all the moves that the predictable engine makes. And then come up with ways to make moves that trick the engine into making bad moves. So it's necessary to have some randomness in your move selection. Yeah. So see, that's trending up very quickly. Meanwhile, our R value is R increasing. Yeah, R is, I guess, steadily increasing. A, I think, is the alpha value, which is generated based on just solely based on the number of iterations and in no way based on the result of each game. And then I don't know if R means how much to change the value, this step thing here. But R might be used to compute how to compute the next value of that step. And indeed, sometimes the weaker engine may end up winning some of these games. So that's why it's important to do lots of simulations to come up with a reasonable estimate. At some point, this is actually going to reach 20, and hopefully, this second number, the one that's currently saying 10 point X there, hopefully, that'll trend down towards zero. And that will tell us basically that not only is 20 the current estimate, but we estimate that a good value can be found in 20 plus or minus zero. Now, they say it's bad to exact, it's bad to hit the best value because then your next estimate will be that best optimal value plus or minus some threshold. This algorithm does try to avoid hitting the best value spot on because, well, rather, if it hits it for one of these parameters, the other parameters might not have the best values yet. The only case where you'd want to hit the ideal value for all the parameters would be if you hit the ideal for all of those all at the same time. And then you'd compute from there that there's no need to change any of them. So yeah, the visualization I gave for this kind of simulation earlier was imagine that there's an agent operating, we'll say in a 3D space, and they have some kind of measurements on how close they are X, Y, and Z wise toward their goal. And so if they figure out that they're the farthest from the goal in this 3D space in the y dimension, then they make a step in the y dimension and measure again and try to guess just what's the best the best next step to make based on where you're currently at. So that's the old way of doing things. The newer way is that you make a measurement on X, Y, and Z directions and proceed toward the goal in each of those directions at the same time, and then measure all three again. And the way you're stepping toward the goal involves all these funky formulas, which I've failed to adequately explain. If you want more details about that, I'm forgetting the professor's name already, but the algorithm he authored, or he wrote a paper about, is the SPSA algorithm. I think the stochastic process, I forget what the S and the A stand for. It's quite a shame. Let me look it up. Let me look this up. SPSA stands... Nope, that's not what I'm looking for. SPSA algorithm is... Oh, I got that very incorrect. So this is an approximation algorithm. It's the simultaneous perturbation stochastic approximation. And break that down. Stochastic means using random numbers, so this definitely uses some, has a randomness associated with it. Not only that, but I think stochastic does refer to the fact that your algorithm or heuristic does necessarily require a random step. This algorithm that we're using very much does so. You saw that the step it's using is a plus or a minus one, but that's a randomly generated plus or minus one. It's an approximation algorithm, in that obviously it's not intended to come up with the ideal value over your n-dimensional space, but just come up with a decent approximation. It's a perturbation algorithm in that we come up with an estimate, and then on each iteration we perturb that estimate each time. So we move it. And simultaneous, the first letter in SPSA, refers to the fact that we're moving in all directions at the same time. So if I had 64 variables here, it would adjust all 64 variables on each iteration and be quite clever in doing so. So that's the notion. And I apologize for taking so long to get to that point and being lazy about looking that up. And the professor's name that was associated most strongly with this, and the first person to write a paper as far as I know about SPSA, his name is... Come on. Oh, man. Oh, I'm sorry. It's Professor Spall at Johns Hopkins University. So yeah, we kind of get the picture that this definitely came up with a good estimate. But its confidence about that estimate is not very high. Maybe that 10 is not so much the step size as it is... maybe I have a very incorrect interpretation of the data. No, that is the step. But I think C in my parameters that are used to run this, C seems to represent the minimum value of the step size, meaning that you're not going to get a unit less than 10 in step size. You see how the second value is converging upon 10. It's not going to go below 10. I'd be surprised if it did. But I could be surprised. So the point of me doing the simulation is just to get a better understanding of what all the parameters in the variable file mean. And what I'm gathering from this now is that that value of 10 might not have been the right thing to choose here, because we want a precision that's at the, let me cancel this, and now that I have a better idea what this is for, we'll change this to a 1, indicating, let's change that to 0.02, indicating that we want a precision of plus or minus 1 when we're done. And I'm starting with an alpha of 0.02, just because I think this, instead of 0.002, to encourage the value to move around a little bit more. I think, in fact, like if I go back here and I change this to 0.02, with an extra O in there, 0.002, actually that has no effect on the initial step size. Yeah, I'm not sure what that 0.002 represents. So maybe 0.002 is just a good default value I should leave in there for all of my testing period. Until, I don't know when, but... So we see that after 20 some iterations that the step size is largely remaining around 1.6-ish. What happens if I change that constant to something much different, like 0.2? What kind of results do we get then? And yeah, you'll see sometimes that the weaker engine does end up winning, so that estimate can go down instead of up. That's very possible. In the long term, obviously, it's going to trend toward 20 because the skill level is, the value of 20 is the best skill level of the engine. Yeah, I think changing that from 0.002 to 0.2 is causing the step size to trend downward more quickly. I'm not entirely sure. So I think I'm going to stick with the default value. That way our step size still does not converge toward 1 before we've had time to converge our estimate toward 20. And yeah, after 500 iterations this does actually hit 20 plus minus 1, then I think I save my changes thus far, and then go on and start changing some source code and see if I can improve the values that are in the source code itself, having to do with just how good or bad it is to put certain kinds of pieces on certain squares. But I think, yeah, having skill level as a good example should make it easier for me to make changes in the source code and understand how to tune things here. So let this run for a little bit. I do need to have some food and clean up a little bit, but I'll be back in just a little bit. Put on your favorite music of choice. I would say if I put music on, I get muted, and that's a bad thing. But I might not even get muted, I don't know. But more importantly, if my video would get muted by my putting music on, that would be problematic because I'm going to come back and talk a little bit more. So I'll be back in a little bit. All right. Well, it appears that our first test or second test is about to complete. We could count the earlier practice tests that we were doing, and who knows how many we've done then. But yeah, while this is trending in the correct direction, it is not trending quickly enough. And so, I don't know. Maybe the answer is just do tons more testing. I'm curious if I scroll back up and look at, say, iteration 100 or so. After 100 iterations, it increased by 0.06. After 200 iterations, it's increasing by about 0.05 each 100 iterations. And so this is increasing, I don't know, at a pretty steady rate. And if I project this out, right. See, if I project this to, like, had I done much more testing, how many iterations would that take to reach a value of 20? Well, so 0.05 is 1/20. I'm sorry, we did 500 tests, and I increased the skill level by roughly a quarter. So if we multiply that quarter by 4, we get 2,000 tests to increase the skill level by 1. And if we assume a constant rate thereafter, which might be a bad assumption, that. So 2,000 tests would increase it from 10 to 11. We need to do that 9 more times. So for a total of 20,000 iterations, this would have finally hit the value of 20. Obviously, that's a lot of iterations. And so I'm curious, I want a precision of plus or minus 1, but what if I change this parameter? Do we converge more quickly upon the answer of 20? I'm just trying to get an understanding of how this works. And unfortunately, this is taking a great deal of time. But yeah, if I change that parameter from 0.002 to 0.02, I guess we're finding pretty readily or pretty rapidly that, well, no, okay, after 12 iterations, we've only slightly increased. Yeah, no, that's not stable, is it? So if you want a high precision estimate, the precision of plus or minus 1, it's going to just take tons of iterations to get there. Otherwise, you will end up randomly walking and bouncing around like this is. Not that 0.02 is any worse than 0.002, but it's just not. Changing how much it bounces around isn't going to make it more reliable. Isn't going to make it. I think what will make this converge faster is if I change that 1 to a 2. Or. Yeah, I need to read up on the difference between that parameter that I just changed versus the alpha parameter in the configuration file. Or I could read the code to try to figure it out, which is a little bit more adventuresome. So maybe we try it that way. So the parameter that I'm talking about is rn, which I guess is the final r value. And indeed, we saw that after 500 iterations, we converged upon that r value. Let's see, rn is used how again? R in the last iteration. R is equal to a divided by c squared. C is the I don't want to say confidence, but maybe that is right, but that's telling us plus or minus that interval in the last iteration. Whereas the R that we're looking for, I guess the correlation constant. Yeah, no, that's actually right. Well, it's not a correlation constant, but it's some kind of formulaic constant about how, I don't know. It's not the correlation constant, but some kind of regressive constant that has to do with how strongly, how much confidence we have in this plus or minus value. Simulation, ELO loss from 0 to plus or minus 100. I'm actually curious what this is used for. ELO is equal to A times chi squared. Simulate ELO. For each chi, ELO loss from 0 to plus minus 100. I think this is just a computed value. I don't think this affects our formula any. Oh, simulate win percentage. Okay. Interesting. I'll have to read about for simulation mode, this defines the ELO decrease compared to optimum. What does this mean? However, if the parameter is very insensitive ELO-wise, one needs to use a larger value for C. See file simul1.var and simul1var.var as an example. So here's the configuration file, simul1.com or simul1var.conf. I think to understand that I need to go over here first. Okay, so the last value here is this 1. I'm not sure if that means 1 ELO point or 1, what am I thinking of? 1%. Probably 1 ELO point. So let's read these again. Simulate equals 1. Oh, I guess simulate means don't actually play the games, just simulate as if games were played. And ELO, okay, I think I understand how that works. If I go over here and I change simulate to 1 and ELO to 100, then it'll pretend that the games were played. Let's change this to a 1. Let's see what we get. Okay, so this simulates as if 500 iterations were performed. If I do this again, shows possible results based on an ELO difference. If I boost that to 100, I'm not exactly sure what to make of this simulation thing. See lots of positive values, although sometimes we get negative values. And if I go back to the configuration file and reset the initial value here of 50,000, and then we do a simulation, okay, so that simulates what if 0 were the optimal value. Okay, so if I want to do a simulation based on 20 being the optimal value, is this what I do? I'm not sure. Maybe that's a measure of how much this value correlates. Yeah. So I think setting, that was weird. Huh. Yeah, I'm not sure what the difference is between all the values I can put here. Yeah, I'm still trying to understand this. Oh, hang on, I changed this a while ago. I should change that back to 0.002 if I want to get an accurate estimation. And then if I set this to 100, does that mean our estimate increases? Okay, so this gives me a sense of how this all works. If you turn simulation to 1, then that last parameter is used instead of a game being played. That's interesting that ended up at that value at the end. So I guess we're as likely to increase as to decrease under that kind of condition. And if I change this to something not necessarily as accurate, yeah, that's interesting. Okay, but I think the issue here is that I started the value at 10 instead of 20. I think 0 there means that 20 is the optimal value, and the test will gravitate toward 20. And if I change this to a 1, I mean, we'll see that we stay pretty close in that range from 18 to 20 there, after lots of games. And this is stochastic, so okay. And suppose I change this to 0.02 instead of 0.002. Okay, it just goes to heck. Interesting. yeah, now I have a better understanding of what a simulation, or not a simulation, but what a test looks like. Normally they don't turn on simulate. Normally they actually run the matches. And so if I want to try to tune toward that, I send that to 10. Now, what's the fastest I can actually run a game under this tuner? Let me take a look at the configuration file again. Base time of 1,000, increment time of 50. So this is 1 second plus 0.05 of a second per move. If I want these games to go a lot faster, that doesn't actually help. If I cut these both by a factor of 5, we should get games in 5 times as quickly. And if I'm super impatient, I don't just cut it by a factor of 5, but a factor of 10. Space time of, well, that's, yeah, we won't even be able to make moves that quickly, but this was initially 1,050. Is there anything I could do to make this move faster? Not that I'm aware of. That's already pretty fast. Yeah, I actually can't speed it up any more than that because it will time out if I try to do this too quickly. I could cut this base time a little bit. Do like that. Concurrency. I'm not sure what concurrency means. Like, if I run this, this doesn't have a parameter concurrency. Engine concurrency, if defined threads, yeah, I'm not sure why it's not called threads instead of concurrency. That seems confusing. Also confusing are those extra semicolons at the ends of these lines, which I'm pretty sure are not necessary. So if I look for thread, join threads, yeah, so I think this just means we're going to run 4 tests at once, as opposed to each engine has 4 threads at a time. So that seems correct. Okay, win move limit equals 8, draw move limit equals 8. Yeah, I don't fully grasp what all this is here for, but I'm sure it's all there for a reason. Yeah, I wonder what alpha versus big A are used for. Can I derive that from looking at the formula? To define both A and alpha, even though we don't use alpha anywhere. Oh, we don't use capital alpha anywhere, we use this here. Meanwhile, we also have, we actually call it dollar A. Okay, so both A and alpha are used in the same formula. Dollar A plus iterations to the power of alpha. Okay, well, I guess that's part of just a scientific formula of some sort. Certainly changing those exponents could have pretty radical effects. Alright, so what have we got? Is there anything I can do to make this simulator run faster? Not really. One thing I could do with the simulation, like if I could set an initial value when simulating and make that differ from the optimal value, that would be an interesting experiment. That'd probably take a lot of coding to change how the SPSA simulates things. Anything else? So, yeah, let's just do one more simulation. Starting at level 0, between 0 and 20. See what an actual simulation does. And how quickly this increases to something greater than 0. So we started at the worst possible value. Told this to go for at most 50,000 iterations, but hopefully it converges before then. So yeah, right now it's just doing simulations of level 0 versus level 2. And we see that level 2 is generally winning it. In fact, that's where we'd expect to see our strongest results. Between higher levels, it might not be so easy to differentiate. I would assume. I could be wrong. I probably am in this case. But I don't know, level 0 is probably pretty weak. So I'm not going to play this out for all 50,000 iterations, but I am curious how quickly this converges upon, say, an estimate of 1 plus or minus 2. Yeah, this converges very slowly. So if I set a less demanding demand and say that this level of R is okay, that I don't need to have that at an interval of plus minus 1 with a R of 0.02. I could do it this way instead. I think this is a value of 0.02 for R establishes a correlation. isn't the same as confidence, but if you have a correlation that's exactly one half, I'm trying to think of how to explain this. I imagine R is a correlation constant, but that doesn't make much sense. R must mean something else here. You know, what we're ultimately interested in is just getting a decent skill level estimate. Okay, I'm gonna have it run at most 500 games. I have not yet had breakfast. I'm gonna have that and be right back. Forgive me for going away. I'll be back for good for next time. Or back for a long time next time. So I need to go eat something. I shall return. Sorry, it finally occurred to me what this means in the README. Let's see, CK for the last iteration, RK for the last iteration. Okay, that's fine. But yeah, here, where it says plus or minus 100 compared to point, what this actually means for a simulation is that 0 means optimal, and 100 means the opposite of optimal. So if I set something to 100, then the estimate is said to be the opposite of what we want, or what will generate a good result. So let me try running a simulation instead of running all these games. I'm going to turn simulation mode back on. Say we do 50,000 iterations in the simulation. And yeah, 100 here says that 0 is the opposite of the optimal value, which it is. So if we did 50,000 games, what result would we expect? Well, let's run it and see. We would expect probably that our value approaches 20. So there you have it. If 0 is the worst possible value, after 50,000 iterations, you might get a value of 14. Now this is based on the Glico formula. Now, let me take a look at it. It's funny how ELO and game log contain the same letters, but so here, yeah, this is simulation of a game, and this is calculation of the win percentage based on I'm not sure. Oh, I'm sorry, this is based on the values that are passed into simulate win percentage. So if you have two player ratings, ELO A and ELO B, the expected win rate for A would be A divided by A plus B. Okay, and this here, what does this say? For each key in my variables, my $A is equal to 1/10,000th of variable IDX that ELO. ELO is incremented by, okay, so it's gonna try for each key and variable. Let me think about that. -1/10,000th of that parameter final value. So this is going to range from -0.01 to 0. I'm going to multiply that by the key to the power of 2. Not sure what the key value is or what $var means, but did I miss something? Yeah, I'm not seeing anything here to suggest that ratings are done differently somehow. Oh, to ±100. Well, that's interesting too. ELO decrease for point x is equal to ±100 compared to point x equals 0. Compared to point x equals 0, what does this mean? I don't understand the sentence. I guess let me try running the simulation outputs again. So it bounces all over the place for those values of A and R. Ultimately coming up with a value of 40. And if I do it again, it might come up with a different value. There's nothing exciting or nothing surprising there. So if I go over here, okay, so if we're looking for a change that makes a 1 point ELO difference, it's going to be hard to, I'm sorry, if the parameter of 100 is 1 point away from the ideal value, then yeah, this will try to stay around 100. But even for these simulations, you see that estimate bounces all over the place. This should stay in the realm of 100, I would imagine. Yeah, it doesn't seem to be doing that. So we see that the final step size is 10, and the final A is 0.2, the final R is 0.02. This is a way of coming up with a decent estimate. Obviously more testing than 50,000 iterations have to be done to come up with exactly the right number, but it's coming up with a number that's roughly in the ballpark. This should be somewhere between 80 and 120 each time the simulation is run. Yeah, this is 95 plus or minus 10. You get the idea. Now, if I want to try another simulation. We see that the simulation stays very close to 100. And yet, if I change this final parameter to be a loss of 100 ELO, we should see pretty rapidly that this degenerates to anything other than 100. That didn't degenerate very quickly, did it? If I increase the step size to 5, oops, wrong file, cert. Okay, that causes it to change. So that's just a way of performing a simulation. I could actually add in another thing here, test var 2, going from minimum of 0 to a maximum of 20. See, 5% of that would be 1. And yeah, let's try that simulation. You see, it's printing out two variables each time. Unfortunately, well, it's difficult to read all that. Because the simulation goes so quickly. Well, that's interesting. I'm surprised. Surprised that skill level estimate stays below 1, even after 50,000 games. Surely if I change the plus or minus step, it'll reach a larger value than 0 pretty quickly. Interesting. It's too bad that's capped at 100, isn't it? What I'm ultimately getting at here is making sure I understand its usage before I change it. So this wants a number between 0 and 100, but what happens if I feed in like a 400 point drop? Would all this know how to handle that? I think so. So I think if I change this back to 1, and I say that there's some parameter that, if tuned to 0, results in losing 400 ELO, I think this is still tuned correctly. 400 is a really extreme, severe drop, but it could happen. Oh. Something broke. I probably divided by 0 somewhere. Anyhow, my machine has gone completely non-responsive. So, success, I guess? I don't know. So let's give that another go. I think I crashed my shell. So that's what I get for not following directions. So yeah, I can't pass in 400 and expect that to work, apparently. So we were going to the SPSA, this synchronous perturbation stochastic estimator, but not estimator, approximation. So I don't understand why I can't put in 400. I'm going to be foolhardy and try a value of 200. Oh, now I understand why it's called Simul1. It's simulating a one variable test. Although now I've added in an extra variable, so I've kind of broken it. Okay, so value over 100 doesn't actually change this in any meaningful way. I I wonder what it would take to be able to simulate a greater drop. So ELO plus equals that key squared. Ten to the power of ELO over 400. Now, I should be able to put in a value of 400, though. I'm reading this right. Okay, my variable ENG1 and ENG2, engine 1 and engine 2, are equal to what's passed into that. Simulate ELO. Yeah, I'm still not understanding. So, minus 0.0001 times the expression that you enter. For each key. Oh, ELO is an array. Okay, that's what's confusing me. It's the fact that this is a one variable simulation doesn't affect the fact that ELO is an array, which it has to be because you have multiple variables. Okay. Yeah, if you have a single variable test, it's going to converge faster than a multivariable test. But such is the nature. Oh, I'm forgetting what it's called. The curse of complexity. The curse of complexity is that if you have a 20 variable equation, that's a lot harder to solve than a one variable equation. Pardon me. So this program neither hurts nor helps that curse of complexity. Yeah, and if you have a single parameter that... Okay, cool. That makes a lot of sense now. So yeah, if you have a variable that's very far from optimal, and this is a reasonable expectation as to what would happen if you tried to tune it. If it loses 100 ELO, 100 rating points, then of course you're going to come up with an estimate that's nowhere near what you started with. Meanwhile, if I change this just a little bit, change this back to what it was, where the value of 100 is now optimal-ish, and you run this, come up with a value that's somewhere in the ballpark of 100. I changed. Yeah, I did change that value from 100 to 5. But this, the way they had it initially is quite instructive, because your problem space isn't just the ballpark of 100, but it's the entire variable space between minus 1,000 and plus 1,000. See, the fact that you're anywhere close to, in fact, yeah, the value of 100 is contained in this interval of 5 plus or minus 100. Still contained here. I think one thing that might make this clearer to people how this works is if you change that from a 1 to a 0, saying that if I just do a diff here, that's the only thing I change from the original test, saying that the value of 100 is optimal. But yeah, you will end up with a result somewhere in not near minus 1,000, not near plus 1,000. And the interval does contain the value of 100. Meanwhile, if you change this to 100 is the opposite of optimal. I think we tried this earlier, but we had a step size of 5 instead of 100. That's curious. Is this always going to return 0 or 200? I wonder. I suppose so. But yeah, if you have a near optimal value and you try to do this tuner on it, chances are you are going to end up with a value that contains 100 in that interval. And if 100 is indeed completely optimal, then yeah, your end result should be between 0 and 200 every time. Not just most of the time, but every time. So this is a bit counterintuitive to see, to see what we're seeing here. Which is that if you have a variable or value that's, and the value we started with was 100, the variable is slightly off, your simulations can run all over the place. Yeah, this is a random process, so say if you were to run this process maybe 100 or 1,000 times, much of the time it will end up with the original value in that interval. So that's all that this is pointing out. I'm still confused why the scale is, like, what if I change this to 0.01? What do we get then? We got about the same thing we got when I set that to 0. Yeah, I'm not sure, but the test data there is fine. It just demonstrates that the results are not entirely intuitive, which is okay. Yeah, no, I think that's right. It's impossible to determine ideal values. That's close enough to the truth. It's closer than what verbiage I put in there. Just having looked at this, what have I changed in the script? Removed some extra punctuation. Allow you to put a space inside the parameter name. Not even sure what I changed on that line. For each row and variables. Oh, I think I got rid of a trailing space. Defined a variable step and used it. Printing out some information from the engines, which is pretty cool. This isn't lining up with those, however, so let's line it up this way. Unless I want to move that back up, and maybe I do. I wonder, can I evaluate something here? How do I evaluate an expression? That didn't do it either. Yeah, I'm gonna look one thing up over here. Perl string print evaluate. How do I evaluate an expression within a string? Okay, so the way to do that would be formatted printing. You can also put your expression into a reference and dereference it inside double quotes. So I really, really, for whatever reason, wanted to say absolute value of step right here as my expression. If I want to do this in Perl, I could say dollar bracket that. I have actually seen that on many occasions too. Because if I like take this out, it tries to evaluate that as a variable as opposed to an interesting. Right, so I'm just curious how this is doable. Perhaps a clearer way of writing this seems to be the first option that's offered. Just apparently putting this inside a list of some sort. Let's try it this way and see what we get. If I run this, can't use that while strict refs is in use. Oh, use strict. Okay, I guess that's to prevent you from doing things you don't intend to do. So, yeah, we'll put this line back. And use strict references when printing this. That's okay. It's ever so slightly more code, but that's totally acceptable. I don't want to line anything up here. Fine, I guess I will. Don't know that it matters, but no, that's actually trickier to read. Yeah, we'll leave this like that. Put this with that. Yeah. So this is anything but symmetric, but I don't know. This seems easy enough to read, at least to me. What else did I change about this script? Oh yeah, just the engine printing. I'm surprised that I was so successful with that. Although, part of that success was copying code, so maybe I shouldn't be so proud of it. But yeah, I've made some useful changes here. And if I want to take a look at those files, actually, star.log, make sure that those are the ones I want to remove, and we'll remove them. Git status, git diff, we'll show you just the files you've changed. Yeah, I want to change this back. We're not going to do a simulation. Okay. Yeah, I don't know that I need to commit. Well, no. What I have is more useful. Because aggressiveness is not a valid option. And giveaway chess is pretty, I don't know, I'll say suspect anyway. Suspect might not be accurate, but yeah, I think I improved this. Let's see, the value of base time used to be 1,000, so I'll change it back to 1,000. So we don't have tests going haywire. What else did I change? No, that seems totally acceptable and fine. Oops. If I'm just interested in those two files changes. Yeah, no, that seems accurate. So this used to say check for x plus or minus 10 within the range 0 to 200. Take it from 0 to 2, change this 10 to a 1, 0.02. I actually increased this factor here. This used to be quite small. And I think we saw. Let me just briefly change this back to do a simulation just for 1 second. If I perform a simulation with these parameters over many iterations, we get a better value than we started with. Or at least there's a high probability that we do. Whereas if I change this back to not that one. If I change the variable, change this to 0.002 and do 50,000, do we end up with a better value? Oh, maybe we do. Yeah. 1 plus or minus 1. Okay, fine. So I guess that alpha value makes some sense. Yeah, coming up with the ideal value is almost never feasible. Coming up with a reasonable estimate, however, is within the ballpark of possibility. Yeah, so if you're just trying to guess roughly what the right value is, let me change this to be a little bit different. If I say 20 and a value of, sure, that actually seems like a reasonable test. You'll see it does converge on 20. And if I change this from, change this to scale, so if we do simulations, it comes up with a pretty high number. Let's Not sure what more to say about that. So now if I, let's see. I think this is the set of final set of values I have here. That seems reasonable. And if I view configuration file and turn off simulation again, remove the log files, git add everything, because this is the version I want to commit. Not sure why I didn't think I moved. That's weird. Skill.var to aggr. Var git move aggr.var to skill.var. Yeah, that's a really strange way of showing the diff. Somehow it concludes that I didn't move the file. I only moved one file, and I ended up deleting a file, and I don't know how it came to that conclusion, because that's not what I did, but I guess it doesn't matter. Git reset head. aggr.var git move aggr.var hang on, we're going to copy this git move that file check out this file. Okay, so I'm confused. Why can I not move this? Git move skill. I am very confused. We have a file, git move aggr.var to skill.var. Destination exists. No, it pretty sure it doesn't. Oh, the file exists on disk. Would help if I spelled my commands correctly now, wouldn't it? Okay, this is how we're going to do that. Get status. Yeah. So apparently, my combination of moving the file and changing its contents causes it to think I'm deleting the file. Whereas in this other case, it recognizes that's a true file move. I don't understand how it makes that distinction, but that's confusing. Maybe I had to edit it. Well, I don't know. I'm speculating at this point. I don't really know. It must intelligently look at the file and see how much it's changed and see, yeah, you didn't actually move that. You just made a different file. I suppose because none of the characters are the same. Whatever. It all amounts to the same result in the end. One could say that in the end it didn't really matter. Okay. So we're going to navigate over here. Oh, sorry, I'm doing this on my other screen because I thought I had to log in to do this. So it's just going to be a brief minute here while I create the repository. As I fork that. Then copy the URL. Git remote v. Git remote remove origin. Git remote add origin this thing. That's not right. I want to do this with SSH. SSH, copy that. There we go. Git checkout. I don't know. We have to come up with a name for it. Git commit. So this was change, replace parameter aggressiveness with skill level. Push origin. Yeah, it confused me there because it said Leela there, but no, it pushed that correctly to the website. All right, I'm sure I've